56 As to the words through which, etc., the meaning is, by reason of which, because of which non-restraint of the eye faculty, if he, if that person, left the eye faculty unguarded, remained with the eye door unclosed by the door panel of mindfulness, these states of covetousness, etc., might invade, might pursue, might threaten, him. He enters upon the way of its restraint, he enters upon the way of closing that eye faculty by the door panel of mindfulness. It is the same one of whom it is said he guards the eye faculty, undertakes the restraint of the eye faculty. 57 Herein, there is neither restraint nor non-restraint in the actual eye faculty, since neither mindfulness nor forgetfulness arises in dependence on eye sensitivity. On the contrary, when a visible datum as object comes into the eye's focus, then, after the life continuum has arisen twice and ceased, the functional mind element accomplishing the function of adverting arises and ceases. After that, eye consciousness with the function of seeing, after that, resultant mind element with the function of receiving, after that, resultant root causeless mind consciousness element with the function of investigating, after that, functional root causeless mind consciousness element accomplishing the function of determining arises and ceases. Next to that, impulsion impels. Point 16 Herein, there is neither restraint nor non-restraint on the occasion of the life continuum, or on any of the occasions beginning with adverting. But there is non-restraint if unvirtuousness or forgetfulness or unknowing or impatience or idleness arises at the moment of impulsion. When this happens, it is called non-restraint in the eye faculty. 22. 58 Why is that? Because when this happens, the door is not guarded, nor are the life continuum and the consciousnesses of the cognitive series. Like what? Just as, when a city's four gates are not secured, although inside the city house doors, storehouses, rooms, etc., are secured, yet all property inside the city is unguarded and unprotected since robbers coming in by the city gates can do as they please, so too, when unvirtuousness, etc., arise in impulsion in which there is no restraint, then the door too is unguarded, and so also are the life continuum and the consciousnesses of the cognitive series beginning with adverting. But when virtue, etc., has arisen in it, then the door too is guarded and so also are the life continuum and the consciousnesses of the cognitive series beginning with adverting. Like what? Just as, when the city gates are secured, although inside the city the houses, etc., are not secured, yet all property inside the city is well guarded, well protected, since when the city gates are shut there is no ingress for robbers, so too, when virtue, etc., have arisen in impulsion, the door too is guarded and so also are the life continuum and the consciousnesses of the cognitive series beginning with adverting. Thus although it actually arises at the moment of impulsion, it is nevertheless called restraint in the eye faculty. 59 So also as regards the phrases on hearing a sound with the ear and so on. So it is this virtue, which in brief has the characteristic of avoiding apprehension of signs entailing defilement with respect to visible objects, etc., that should be understood as virtue of restraint of faculties. 60, c. Now, as regards the virtue of livelihood purification mentioned above next to the virtue of restraint of the faculties, 42, the words of the six precepts announced on account of livelihood mean, of the following six training precepts announced thus, with livelihood as cause, with livelihood as reason, one of evil wishes, a prey to wishes, lays claim to a higher than human state that is non-existent, not a fact, the contravention of which is defeat, expulsion from the order, with livelihood as cause, with livelihood as reason, he acts as go-between, the contravention of which is an offense entailing a meeting of the order, with livelihood as cause, with livelihood as reason, he says, a bhikkhu who lives in your monastery is an arahant, the contravention of which is a serious offense in one who is aware of it, with livelihood as cause, with livelihood as reason, a bhikkhu who is not sick eats superior food that he has ordered for his own use, the contravention of which is an offense requiring expiation, with livelihood as cause, with livelihood as reason, A bhikkhuni who is not sick eats superior food that she has ordered for her own use, the contravention of which is an offense requiring confession, with livelihood as cause, with livelihood as reason, one who is not sick eats curry or boiled rice. 23 That he has ordered for his own use, the contravention of which is an offense of wrongdoing, Ven v 146. Of these six precepts, point 17. 61 As regards scheming, etc., 42, this is the text, herein, what is scheming? It is the grimacing, grimacery, scheming, schemery, schemedness. 18 By what is called rejection of requisites or by indirect talk, or it is the disposing, posing, composing, of the deportment on the part of one bent on gain, honor, and renown, of one of evil wishes, a prey to wishes. This is called scheming. 62 Herein, what is talking? Talking at others, talking, talking round, talking up, continual talking up, persuading, continual persuading, suggesting, continual suggesting, ingratiating chatter, flattery, being supery, fondling, on the part of one bent on gain, honor, and renown, of one of evil wishes, a prey to wishes. This is called talking. 63 Herein, what is hinting? A sign to others, giving a sign, indication, giving indication, indirect talk, roundabout talk, on the part of one bent on gain, honor, and renown, of one of evil wishes, a prey to wishes. This is called hinting. 64 Herein, what is belittling? Abusing of others, disparaging, reproaching, snubbing, continual snubbing, ridicule, continual ridicule, denigration, continual denigration, tail-bearing, backbiting, on the part of one bent on gain, honor, and renown, of one of evil wishes, a prey to wishes. This is called belittling. 65 Herein, what is pursuing gain with gain? Seeking, seeking for, seeking out, going in search of, searching for, searching out material goods by means of material goods, such as carrying their goods that have been got from here, or carrying here goods that have been got from there, by one bent on gain, honor, and renown, by one of evil wishes, a prey to wishes. This is called pursuing gain with gain. 19, Vibhai 352-53. 66 The meaning of this text should be understood as follows, firstly, as regards description of scheming, on the part of one bent on gain, honor, and renown is on the part of one who is bent on gain, on honor, and on reputation, on the part of one who longs for them, is the meaning. 24 Of one of evil wishes, of one who wants to show qualities that he has not got. A prey to wishes. 20 The meaning is, of one who is attacked by them. And after this the passage beginning or by what is called rejection of requisites is given in order to show the three instances of scheming given in the Mahanadisa as rejection of requisites, indirect talk, and that based on deportment. 67 Herein, a bhikkhu is invited to accept robes, etc., and, precisely because he wants them, he refuses them out of evil wishes. And then, since he knows that those householders believe in him implicitly when they think, oh, how few are our Lord's wishes. He will not accept a thing, and they put fine robes, etc., before him by various means, he then accepts, making a show that he wants to be compassionate towards them. It is this hypocrisy of his, which becomes the cause of their subsequently bringing them even by cartloads, that should be understood as the instance of scheming called rejection of requisites. 68 For this is said in the Mahanadisa, what is the instance of scheming called rejection of requisites? Here householders invite bhikkhus to accept robes, alms food, resting place, and the requisite of medicine as cure for the sick. One who is of evil wishes, a prey to wishes, wanting robes, alms food, resting place, the requisite of medicine as cure for the sick, refuses robes, alms food, resting place, the requisite of medicine as cure for the sick, because he wants more. He says, what has an ascetic to do with expensive robes? It is proper for an ascetic to gather rags from a charnel ground or from a rubbish heap or from a shop and make them into a patchwork cloak to wear. What has an ascetic to do with expensive alms food? It is proper for an ascetic to get his living by the dropping of lumps of food into his bowl while he wanders for gleanings. What has an ascetic to do with an expensive resting place? It is proper for an ascetic to be a tree root dweller or an open air dweller. What has an ascetic to do with an expensive requisite of medicine as cure for the sick? It is proper for an ascetic to cure himself with putrid urine 21 and broken gallnuts. Accordingly, he wears a coarse robe, eats coarse alms food. 25 uses a coarse resting place, uses a coarse requisite of medicine as cure for the sick. Then householders think, this ascetic has few wishes, is content, is secluded, keeps aloof from company, is strenuous, is a preacher of asceticism, and they invite him more and more to accept robes, alms food, resting places, and the requisite of medicine as cure for the sick. He says, with three things present a faithful clansman produces much merit, with faith present a faithful clansman produces much merit, with goods to be given present a faithful clansman produces much merit, with those worthy to receive present a faithful clansman produces much merit. You have faith, the goods to be given are here, and I am here to accept. If I do not accept, then you will be deprived of the merit. That is no good to me. Rather will I accept out of compassion for you. Accordingly he accepts many robes, he accepts much alms food, he accepts many resting places, he accepts many requisites of medicine as cure for the sick. Such grimacing, grimacery, scheming, schemery, schemedness, is known as the instance of scheming called rejection of requisites, Nidhi 224-25.